Having studied some local homological properties of a simplicial complex, and then having studied the properties of local homological properties of a triangulated manifold, we were led to make the following definition now. A simplicial complex which satisfies property 2, 3, 4 of the above theorem is called a pseudo-manifold of dimension n. So this was the theorem that we proved last time. Let us go through that theorem first. So this was the statement. Take a connected, compact, topological n-manifold without boundary. Let K be a simplicial complex such that mod K is equal to X. In other words, it is a connected, compact, topological, n-dimensional manifold which is triangulated. Then the following holds. For all non-empty faces of K, we have HI tuple of link of F is 0. For I less than the dimension of F, and isomorphic to Z for I equal to dimension of the link, which can be stated in a nutshell, namely link of F looks like a homology sphere. Up to homologies looks like a sphere of dimension equal to dimension of the link. The second statement is that K is pure of dimension n. Third statement is that every n minus 1 facet of K occurs at the face of exactly two simplexes. The fourth condition says that from one simplex n simplex to another n simplex, we can go by a path of n simplexes. A path of n simplexes is a sequence S1, S2, Sk such that the intersection of Si with Si plus 1 is exactly an n minus 1 phase. Okay, it starts with S1 equal to say sigma and Sk equal to tau, then it's a path from sigma to tau. Okay, this condition, especially along with of course 2 and 3, no topological manifold now. We forget about manifold, only these conditions you assume. Okay, suppose these things are true. Forget about compactness, forget about connectivity. Connectivity comes from automatically from here. Okay, make those as axioms for what you may call it as pseudo manifold. 2, 3, and 4. Okay. If you replace the condition 3 by instead of saying exactly 2, at most 2, that means an n simplex may have, an n minus 1 simplex may have only one n simplex containing it. Instead of 2. Of course, the pure means there will be at least one. Okay. So if there is only one, then that kind of simplexes will become boundary part. Okay, so then you will get manifolds with boundary. Okay, so now having made a definition, we have the following corollary. Given any connected, compact, n-dimensional pure, that's why n-dimension is there, but we don't know whether it is manifold or not. Okay, dimension. Triangulated pseudo-manifold K, pseudo-manifold, with or without boundary. There exists a triangulated convex polyhedron P in Rn and an affine linear isomorphism phi I from Fi to Fi prime, where F1, F2, Fk and F1 prime, Fk prime are some distinct facets of P, okay, such that K is the quotient of P, namely the polyhedron, by the boundary identification. These are all boundary identifications. What is the identification? X is identified with phi I fx, whenever x is inside I, pairwise. If you take this, this is exhaust all the boundary faces, then K will not have any boundary. So then boundary of K will be empty, if and only if. So that is the statement. So this is the something very simple-minded thing, but it is the starting point of our classification for two-dimensional manifolds. Indeed, this is the way how Poincaré perceived the whole thing, and even for three dimension, he tried to classify like this. Unfortunately, after several, you know, almost whole century of people trying his program, trying to complete his program, it has failed in some sense. But for n equal to 2, we are going to use it, and it will be very, very useful. Having said that, it is useful to a large extent, but the whole classification problem could not be solved by first starting from here. Even in dimension 3, it was tried and very difficult. And later on, it was just given up. So this was not useful and so on. So, but it gives you already a lot of information on the topology of a manifold, triangulated manifold. Okay, so let's go through the proof of this one today. We start with labeling the vertices, labeling the n simplexes of K. Okay, if there is only one, there is nothing, no other condition. You just label it as one, that's all. For I greater than or equal to any n simplex sigma I, sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma n, etc. There are only finitely, it's a compact thing, so there are only finitely many of them. Okay. So sigma 2 has at least one n minus 1 face. That is a facet. I will keep using that. N minus 1 face are called facet. Common with sigma j, j less than I. So if sigma 2 will have, there is only one sigma 1, it will have only one face. But when you go sigma 2, sigma 3, sigma 3, you have got a conglomerate. You don't know how complicated it looks like. Okay. So what is the condition? Condition is one of the sigma j's will share one of its face, facet, with the new one, sigma j plus 1. Or sigma I, whatever, next one. Okay. So that is the... So J less than I, which one you don't know. So this is what, for all, if you take all of them, one of them will share it. Okay. And this is possible because of condition 4, that starting with sigma 1, if there is no condition, this condition is not satisfied, that would mean that you have got two disjoint collections. This sigma 1 is one, and all the other ones, none of them will intersect this one. That will be, that will contradict our assumption, because from sigma 1 I can go to any other thing by a sequence of this n simplex path. So there must be another one starting, which will lead all the way up to whatever sigma I have chosen. Okay, the moment you don't find such a thing, then there will be a contradiction. There will not be a path like that. Okay. So take up to sigma, you have taken something which satisfies this one. How do you construct the next one? If there is a next one, there must be a path from that to one of the things which you have selected. Took any one of them. So which means in between, you may hit something else. Though whenever you first time hit that one, you select that one. Just like you argue with a path. Okay, so it's condition 4 that has to be used. Okay. So once you have arranged it like that, let Kj be the subcomplex spanned by sigma i's less than I less than equal to j. Now what I am going to do, inductively we shall construct triangulated convex polyhedrons P1 contains a P2, contains a Pj and so on, up to whatever Pk. I don't care how many are there, which is finite. All of them subspaces of Rn. Okay. And surjective simplicial maps theta j from Pj to Kj below. The K1, K2, Kj's are already well defined now, such that for each j, the following three conditions hold. Okay. Theta j is a bijection on each simplexes. Okay. Remember, theta j is defined on Pj. What is Pj? Pj will be union of various simplexes. Okay. And two corresponding simplex. For each simplexes, it is a bijection. Theta j restricted to Pj minus 1 is theta j minus 1. That means each successive theta j's are extensions of the previous ones. The third condition is F is any one of the boundary facets of Pj is convex polyhedron. Remember that. Look at a boundary facet. Then theta j is a homeomorphism on, if you restrict it to interior of Pj union this facet. If you take the whole of Pj with along with boundary, it may not be injective. In other words, injectivity fails at each stage, if at all, only from one facet to some other facet on the boundary. That is the condition C. Okay. For example, when j equal to 1, theta 1, I have just taken one convex one tetrahedron or one whatever n simplex, and that is a bijection on the whole of it. Okay, so this condition looks like weaker condition, but this is all we can ensure as we keep going up. Condition C, okay, so this will help us to prove the next condition also, by the way. If I just say it is interior, it's injection, that's not enough. Okay, so let us see how we are going to do this. For j equal to 1, let P1 be any geometric n simplex in X. Geometric n simplex means what? Convex hull of n plus 1 points. I don't care how it looks like. It will be a convex, it is a triangulator because there is only one simplex. Okay, so P1 is any one of them. Okay, one geometry simplex to start with. And let theta 1 more P1 to K1, where K1 is just what? K1 is sigma 1. Be the bijection of vertices. On the vertices, if the bijection, automatically, when you extend it, it will be an isomorphism. Clearly, A, B, C are satisfied. Okay. Suppose inductively we have arrived at the stage J, the construction is over. Okay, P1 contains a P2 contains a Pj. Pj is a convex polyhedron triangulated and it satisfies the theta j satisfies the three conditions. Okay, now look at sigma j plus 1. By the very choice of this labeling, this will share at least one n minus 1 facet of prime with some simplex tau inside Kj. Okay, it may share more also. Fix such an F prime. It follows that sigma j plus 1, the new simplex, is this F prime union some vertex view. For a unique vertex, you belong to Kj plus 1. Kj plus 1 is what? Kj union sigma j plus 1. So it will be inside sigma j plus 1. So it will be Kj plus 1. But what may happen is this, the extra vertex may be already inside Kj. This can happen. But we don't have any objection for that. Okay. So now let F contain this a Pj. There will be some. You see, if it is f prime is inside kj, there will be one n minus one facet f inside pj such that theta j of f is f prime, because theta j is surjective mapping, right? So it follows that f must be also the boundary component, because here in below, inside kj it is a boundary component. Okay, so in pj also it must be a boundary component. Okay, consider the region. Now I want to construct pj plus 1. How do I construct pj plus 1? So I have a convex polyhedron and I have located one of the facets on the boundary. Okay, so consider the convex region bounded by the hyperplanes spanned by f. Each facet, which is an n minus 1 simplex, okay, inside Rn, if you take the linear span of that instead of convex, it's the convex span of that, okay, affine span of that, that's the correct word, affine span of that, that will be a hyperplane. Okay, like that, you take all the other hyperplanes spanned by all the other facets which intersect f. Okay, take such a thing. Then look at the outer regions defined, that it will be defined a convex region, which is actually usually unbounded region. Defined the one which is outer to the convex polyhedron. Okay, take that plane. The span by f and other facets here intersecting f. Take w to be any point in the interior of this convex region. Then rho is the convex hull of w and f. So I have now found another convex thing there, which is nothing but an n simplex now. Okay, and put pj plus 1 equal to the convex hull of pj union rho. The pj is already convex, so this pj will be there, union rho will come because rho is another convex cell. So look at this picture, it will tell you have constructed up to here and you have located the boundary of, this is pj, okay, and this is f is one of the boundary components. Boundary facet. Now look at this plane, and all that. At all of them intersecting this F. Coming from here, here, this one comes, and so on. Okay. There will be a convex region. This is the intersection of all of them. Okay. Outer to this convex region, outer to the convex polyhedron. Inside that, choose a boundary, choose some point W like here. Okay, then take the convex hull of F and omega, of F and W. So that is my rho. This is the n simplex. Okay, here in the picture, it is all n equal to 2 only, R2, right? Automatically, this P union rho will be a convex region. If you choose it here, for example, this point, it will not be. If you choose it here, it will not be. Okay, that is the whole idea. If you choose it here, it will not be. If you take and draw a triangle like this, that will not be a convex region along with this one. So this is the criteria where to choose this W. And it can be chosen very easily. Okay. So do that, then it will be a convex region. Now you map this extra rho, whatever you have got, to sigma j plus 1. F all on theta is already defined here. So f goes to f prime by isomorphism. All this, the w will go to u and extend it linearly. That will be theta j plus 1. Okay, so now take theta prime of j plus 1 of w is equal to u, and theta prime of j plus 1 on f equal to theta j, extend it linearly over rho. So you have got theta j plus 1 prime here, and theta j defined all over here, patch them up together, because on f they agree. So that is my theta j plus 1. Theta j plus 1 on pj is theta j, theta j plus 1 on rho is theta j plus 1. Okay, so the construction is over, but we have to prove, you know, all these conditions. What are these conditions? These two are we have already done. Okay, but condition three, condition I have to prove. Up to j, you have assumed this one. For j plus 1, you have to prove this one. Then only construction, inductive construction will be over. So here is the worst scenario is like this here. You know, even in this case, condition C will be true. So what I have got here is, to begin with, you have this, this is your K. Okay, let us say, consisting of seven of the triangles here in the picture. Seven of the whatever you may think, simplexes, whatever. Okay, I have labeled, the labeling could be quite arbitrary, right? So, for example, I could have started from here and gone like this. I have started here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, then 7. So, accordingly, I construct 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let us say, and the seventh stage, what happens? Up to 6, you have constructed. Okay. The seventh simplex is sigma 7. What has happened? It is sharing one facet here with 6. Okay. And then I have constructed this correspond here. This will be my point W, and that will be mapped to this point and extended over. So construction is over. Now, why condition C is true? What does condition C say? You take the entire interior of this one. Take any one of the boundary facets here, any one of them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, any one of them. Union that theta j must be a homeomorphism, must be injective. Injectivity, once you prove injectivity, homeomorphism will be over here. That is what you have to show. Okay. So suppose I have taken this one. This is already in the in theta 6. So that condition is automatically satisfied for this part, and I have got this part injective, that's easy, right? So anytime I have the boundary facet is already inside PJ, there is not much difficulty to prove the whole thing. But suppose this is the one. But if this is the one I am taking, I am not taking any other facets here, okay? Interior of this, and this edge I am taking here. Okay, where is this edge going here? The edge will go to this part. Okay, this is 6, 1. Edge will be going to this one, 7 and 1. Remember, the other boundary component of 1 is here. And I am not including that in the picture, in this one. I am talking only interior. Right? Therefore, only restricted to this part, it is still injective. If I include this edge as well as this edge, then it will not be injective. Okay, so this picture tells you the whole story actually. I have to write down the proof in general, not just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so we need to verify condition C. First of all, notice that theta j from pj to kj is a closed mapping. Each of them is a quotient, but it's a very special quotient. In particular, it's a closed mapping, because what we have got is a compact space to a Hausdorff space. Okay, so it's a closed mapping. A closed surjections, it's also a quotient map, has a special property, like open quotients are special properties. So you use that one. Theta j plus 1 being equal to theta j on interior of PJ union F Okay, this part is homeomorphism by induction hypothesis. Also, theta j plus 1 prime, remember what is it? It is the definition of theta, extending theta on the new simplex at j plus 1, okay, on the row. Is it a homeomorphism from row onto sigma j plus 1? It follows that theta j plus 1 is a homeomorphism of interior of Pj union row. So if you have two sets A and B, on A it is a homeomorphism, B it is a homeomorphism, okay, to different subsets C and D, such that on the intersection, goes to the intersection, A intersection B goes to A intersection B, then the union, on the union it will be homeomorphism. Okay, so something like this I am using here, okay. So it follows that theta j plus 1 is homeomorphism on this part. Okay, now this is one part. Now take G be any boundary facet of Pj plus 1. If G is already in the boundary, you have already got it. Boundary of rho, okay, then there is nothing to prove. Otherwise, G is a boundary facet of Pj and is different from Fj. Okay, therefore, from the induction hypothesis again, theta j is a homeomorphism G in an interior Pj. Moreover, theta j, under theta j, G and F, okay, are mapped onto different facets. Okay, in K, it follows that theta j plus 1 is injective on G union interior of Pj plus 1. G is any facet, any other facet is also true. Okay, so it's easily checked that it is also a closed mapping, injective, continuous, and a closed mapping, and hence it's a homeomorphism. There may be several ways of proving that it's a homeomorphism, but noticing that it's a closed mapping will help you to prove this one very easily. Finally, what do you do? What is theta? Theta is just theta j on Pj. It's well defined because on Pj plus 1, theta j plus 1, if you take on Pj, it will be theta j itself. Okay. So it follows that theta is a homeomorphism in the interior of P. If you take any one facet, there also it's injective. But now I am going to say something better than that. What I am saying there again, on each facet, theta is injective. Okay, it's a homeomorphism there also, restricted to. Restricted to somewhere. The image may not be a boundary. Why? Because this facet may be covered by another also. It may happen that two distinct facets are mapped onto the same facet in K. Label them in pairs, Fi and Fi prime. A third one will never come. Why? Because each facet here accounts for an N simplex. And any facet in K can be at most, face of at most two N simplexes only. Okay, so that is used here. Okay, so label them Fi and Fi prime. How do I label them? The property that under theta, they are mapped to the same facet. Okay, put psi I equal to theta restrict Fi, psi prime equal to theta restrict Fi prime, phi I equal to psi I inverse of psi I prime inverse of psi I. So these are the relations now from Fi to Fi prime. Okay, this is homeomorphism. It follows that under theta, K is then isomorphic as a simplicial complex to the quotient space of P. When you say quotient space, what is the relation? Relations are this phi I. So that is the statement of this theorem. The P I's and phi I's, whatever. Okay, there are phi I's. FPI from FI to FI prime, linear isomorphisms such that X is identified as phi I of X. So that completes the proof of this theorem. So let me make a few remarks before closing up. The method of proof in the above theorem is the beginning of a technique known as cut and paste technique. Where you are cutting, you started with an N simplex, cut it and paste it in Rn. Okay, that is the meaning of cutting and pasting. Then wherever you have cut, you look for another N simplex there, from there, cut it and bring it and place it in Rn. While you are placing it, you have some freedom. You what is the freedom? Because you are a topologist, you are not doing any geometry here. So you can change the size of the simplex. But wherever you have cut it from, you have to place it in the corresponding thing there. So here they are the ones which are joining. Okay. So this is something which is somewhat strange, in the sense that in topology, you are not supposed to cut things. That would be what? That's it, like you are doing something discontinuous. The continuity has to be established. Wherever you have cut, that is only temporary, you are pasting along the same thing, same homeomorphism. Okay, up to homeomorphism, you are pasting the same parts. So that is why it is allowed. So it's called cut and paste technique. Almost half a century of mathematicians were trying to do this one, in at least in dimension 3. Okay, dimension 3, this has become a big industry. A lot of results were proved, yet the final proof, namely the all that they were trying to do, the Poincare conjecture in tridimension, could not be proved from this technique. Okay, so that's why I'm calling it as low dimension topology, usually means 3 and 4 dimensions. In the next section, we shall use this technique to classify surfaces. Okay, we are going to do that. Conversely, given a triangulated convex polyhedron P in Rn, and a pairwise facet identification data, as in the theorem that we have proved. Suppose we start with such a thing. Okay, then we can ask a question, namely, is the quotient a simplicial complex so that the quotient map is simplicial? That is the first question, which is answered quite easily anyway. Let us take the second question. Assuming one is true, is the quotient a topological manifold? Starting with any pseudo manifold itself, you can do this one. Is the theorem there? So why the reversing, when you reverse, why you ask a topological manifold? Obviously, it will not be true, right? So in fact, both the questions have obviously negative answers. And that is precisely why they are good questions. Because now you have to put some extra conditions, more extra conditions of your own choice, so that there will be a positive answers. Okay, so let me discuss it a little bit, a few minutes only. As an answer to one is negative in general, an answer to one is negative in general. Okay, however, if we take the second barycentric subdivision of P, the P is a triangulated polyhedron. Okay. It may be, just for example, you may have one single line segment divided into two portions. Okay. That means union of two line segments, but it is a convex one. Now you identify the endpoints. It is not going to be a simplicial complex. Very obvious reason, right? Very obvious way. So he easily fails. But there is a beautiful answer here. If you start with a convex polyhedron and a patching up data on the boundary, no matter what polyhedron is, if you take second barycentric subdivision of that, then the quotient inherits a simple shear structure such that the quotient map is simply shear. I will leave this one to you because I am not going to use it in this course anyway. So you think about this one. This is just a remark. The second answer, the answer to second question is also in the negative. I told you, I have already told you. Some extra condition is necessary. However, this is changing. Dimension less than or equal to 1 and 2. Okay. There is no need to put any extra condition. So this is again a clever thing. And the dimension 2 thing, one thing is easy to can verify. Dimension 2, we are going to use it actually. True. In dimension 3, there is a very nice condition in terms of the Euler characteristic. And this condition is due to Poincaré. It is very interesting one. And that is the one, perhaps, I guess, encourage Poincaré to try to classify all three-dimensional manifolds. Okay? So next time, we will discuss this result due to Poincaré. And another one, which is not related one, of course, just to fit the module, we will discuss another important result due to Munkres. Thank you.